Enzymes are one of the most fundamental components of life. Without them, multicellular life would likely have never gotten off the ground. Today we're going to learn what enzymes are, what they do, how they work, and about some particularly important ones. Think of any biological process. Let's take cell division as an example. Without the molecules interacting with each other in exactly the right way and changing in precisely the right order, the reaction either can't happen or goes haywire. We either end up with the same soup we started with, or we end up with lots of things we don't want. So how do biological processes function in the right order at the right times and between the right molecules? The answer was discovered, in part, in 1833 by a French chemist called Anselme Payen, and it involves proteins called enzymes. In order for a chemical reaction to happen, it needs to surpass something called the activation energy. Typically, this energy is supplied in the form of heat. Think about cooking an egg. When you crack it into the pan, it's a rather unpleasant goop. But soon, with some heat, chemical reactions happen that turn it into a delicious breakfast. Much the same has to happen for each biological process. But, as you'll have learned from breakfast, simply adding heat is a very imprecise way to create biochemical reactions. You end up with a lot of cooked cells. And if you don't end up cooking the cells, you'll also activate a number of unhelpful and unwanted reactions. So heat alone is not a good way to organize biological functions that we depend on. What's needed instead is a catalyst to make reactions happen more precisely. A catalyst is something that speeds up the rate of reaction without itself being used up in the process. This is exactly what enzymes are. They speed up specific reactions by reducing the activation energy required for those molecules to react. They do this by having what's called an active site that the substrate molecules can fit into, like puzzle pieces. When the enzyme and a substrate fit together, they form an enzyme-substrate complex, and it's this set of interactions that reduces the activation energy. Imagine the enzyme is a compactor. It reduces the activation energy in two main ways. First, if separate substrate molecules enter the active site, they're compacted together. They're held close together so they can bond more easily, which is called synthesis. Or second, if a single substrate molecule enters the active site, then it's broken down by the strain placed on the bonds. So the question is, how does the active site work so specifically for the right combination of substrate molecules? Originally, scientists came up with a model called the lock and key model for how the active site works. The idea here is, just like two puzzle pieces, the activation will only happen when the substrate molecule perfectly fits into the active site. But this doesn't fully explain why they're so specific. The substrate structure being the same structure as the active site doesn't explain why it's also held there. For example, if you put a key in a lock, the key can also fall out or be easily removed, but this doesn't happen with enzymes. So scientists modified the lock and key model to one that's called the induced fit model. Instead of the reaction happening simply when a substrate is the right shape, the substrate must also change the shape of the active site so that it's locked in. This way, the substrate is held more tightly and the reaction can be catalyzed much more effectively. Now let's look at some specific enzymes, focusing on ones which are particularly common or particularly important. Amylase helps to digest carbohydrates, specifically helping to change starch into sugars via hydrolysis. It's made in your salivary glands and pancreas, so this helps to begin the chemical process of food digestion as soon as the food is in your mouth. Maltase is also produced by your pancreas and salivary glands. It helps to break maltose into the simpler sugar, glucose. It's also found in plants, bacteria, and yeast. Trypsin catalyzes the breakdown of proteins in the small intestine, breaking them into amino acids. Protease also helps to break down proteins into single amino acids through hydrolysis. So they help with protein catabolism, and therefore the body growth and cell signaling that comes with this process. Sucrase catalyzes the reactions that hydrolyze sucrose to yield the formation of fructose and glucose. Thrombokinase helps with the process of blood coagulation, so it helps to seal wounds and stop them from becoming infected. DNA polymerase is crucial to the process of DNA replication through the synthesis of DNA. And last but not least, respiration oxidase helps with the process of aerobic respiration by catalyzing the reduction of oxygen, which helps to generate an electrochemical gradient, which is useful for other cellular processes. Now that we've looked at how enzymes work and some common examples of them, there's something important to note. It's a common misconception that the lock and key and induced fit models are two ways in which enzymes work, but they're actually two successive theories for why enzymes work the way they do. The induced fit model is an improvement on the older lock and key model, and there's every chance that it will itself be improved upon with more research and discovery. Crucially, because it's not certain that active sites and substrate shapes fit, one must describe them as having complementary shapes. So we've learned about enzymes, that they catalyze biological reactions, and the ways in which they do so. See you next time.